It looks like a laptop, feels like a laptop, so it's a laptop, right? To answer that question, we need more context, and I ask you how you define a laptop. If it's that portable device with a screen, keyboard and trackpad, with a battery and charger, with a webcam and speakers, then yes, the Vivobook S15 is just that. It has a nice OLED screen, a keyboard with a numpad section, a gigantic trackpad, a 70 watt-hour battery, and all this in a sleek aluminum chassis weighing under 1.5 kilos. But the real revolution is under the hood, because finally we have an ARM processor on a laptop outside the Apple ecosystem. 4 years after the VM1 and with a serious push for Microsoft, we finally have credible ARM solutions on Windows laptops. Before I tell you the specifications of the Vivobook S15, let's discuss a bit why ARM is good news for Windows laptops. As Apple has already proved, a laptop built around the ARM architecture will have significantly better battery life compared to those with an x86 processor, whether we're talking about Intel or AMD. Oh, so if it has good battery life, does that mean it has poor performance? No. This is because these processors are very efficient. A disclaimer, however, most applications that Windows users currently use are optimized for the x86 architecture. When they run on ARM, unoptimized applications require emulation, so performance will suffer. However, in applications optimized for ARM, these processors show excellent efficiency, paired with equally good performance. In this laptop, we have a Snapdragon X Elite, more precisely, the X1E78100 version. Built in TSMC's fabs on 4nm technology, Snapdragon X Elite is an SoC, meaning system on a chip, that includes, among other things, an Adreno 740 GPU and an NPU capable of 45 trillion operations per second. This number of operations per second is more important than you think, because it allows the Vivobook S15 to run Copilot Plus. But we'll get to that. Qualcomm's CPU has 12 cores, clocked at a maximum of 4.5 GHz, but these numbers are not directly comparable to what we knew until now, because the architecture is fundamentally different. Since we're talking about an SoC, memory speed is vital for system performance. The Vivobook S15 has 32GB of RAM in the version tested by us, and we're not talking about any type of memory, but LPDDR5X, clocked at no less than 8448 MHz. Storage is provided by a 1TB NVMe SSD, and on the connectivity side, the laptop boasts Wi-Fi 7, Bluetooth 5.4, and physical ports. Not many, but very fast. We have two USB 4 Type-C ports with support for external 4K displays and transfer rates up to 40 gigabits per second, two USB 3.2 Gen 1 Type-A ports, an HDMI 2.1 port, a micro SD card reader, and an audio combo jack. The screen is a glossy 15.5-inch OLED from the Asus Lumina OLED series with a resolution of 2880 by 1620 pixels, so a 16:9 aspect ratio, a 120Hz refresh rate, a maximum brightness of 600 nits in HDR, and 100% coverage of the DCI-P3 color spectrum. I would have liked a 16:10 aspect ratio, but the screen is superb, and honestly, there is no other technology that even comes close to what these OLEDs offer. The multimedia section is complemented by a full HD camera with Windows Hello support and an audio system developed in collaboration with Harman Kardon, which sounds okay-ish. So far, we have a decent device, typical of the Vivobook series, which looks and feels like a regular laptop. But let's turn it on and see what it can do and how it performs. As I said earlier, being an ARM system, most applications will go through emulation, so performance will not be as good as when running natively, at least for now. However, we don't live in the future, and the reality of the present says that whoever buys a Vivobook S15 now will use it with what it is available at this moment. And that's why I decided not to play nice with Microsoft or Qualcomm, but instead to run the tests we usually run on x86 systems, which are not necessarily optimized for ARM. For example, in Cinebench R23, where the processor was labeled as virtual CPU, we got 10,206 points in multi-core, a score close to a Core Ultra 7 165U or a desktop Ryzen 5500. Honestly, it's more than I expected under these circumstances. In Cinebench 2024, which has an ARM version, the multi-core score was even better, 971 points. This puts the VivoBook S15 on par with laptops with Intel Core i9-13900H, systems with Ryzen 7 8700G and Apple devices with M3 Pro. Compared to the M3 in the MacBook Air, the Snapdragon X Elite has a score 50% higher, which is huge. If you want a direct comparison, my own Apple laptop with M3 Max scored nearly 1400 points, more precisely 1380 in Cinebench 2024. So the nearly 1000 points of the VivoBook are really impressive. We also ran Geekbench 6, where the VivoBook S15 scored 1,648 points in multi-core and 2,465 in single-core. These results are excellent, similar to those of an i7-13700 or desktop Ryzen 7-8700G. The MacBook Air M3 scores around 12,000, so again a victory for the Snapdragon X Elite. For the graphics subsystem, we ran the same tests as on laptops with x86 processors. In FireStrike, the VivoBook S15 scored 6200 points, with 6599 for the graphics subsystem, 16431 points for physics, and 12598 combined score. Compared to our recent tests, this score is higher than that of a VivoBook 14 OLED with an i9-13900H and Iris Xe, which scored 5637 points, and below an AMD 8600G APU. In TimeSpy, the situation was less cheerful, with a score of 1841 points, 1661 for graphics, and 4788 for CPU. We also decided to run Wildlife Extreme, which you usually use to test phones. Here we scored 6303 points, a bit below the MacBook Pro with M2, which scored 6800 points, and quite far behind the MacBook Air M3, which scored around 8200 points. As a fun fact, a Samsung S23 Ultra phone scores approximately 3800 points in the same test, although it has the same graphics subsystem. The main difference is mainly because it can't cool itself as well as a laptop. We also ran Superposition Benchmark for about 0.5 seconds before the application crashed, as it wasn't accustomed to ARM. The last test we ran was Blender 3.6, again, an application not optimized for ARM. Here too, we received an error, so we couldn't get scores. Childhood pains, what I can say. Speaking of growing up, I also ran Counter-Strike, like a true gamer who doesn't care if he's playing on a completely unsuitable system. If it's stupid and it works, it's not stupid. Well, it doesn't really work, so it is stupid. At 1080p resolution with details on low, we had somewhere between 40 and 70 FPS, but with absolutely dreadful stutters and frame drops. Probably, with some patches and updates, you could play on the VivoBook S15, but don't expect miracles from an Adreno 740. Another important mention is that currently there is no ray tracing support for this platform. But putting the tests aside, how is the laptop? Well, I would say it feels less fluid than a laptop on the x86 platform, but the differences are small. In productivity-related applications, this laptop is in its element, but it occasionally lags, like any platform that is just starting out. Even so, the future looks good, and I'm not talking about a hardware upgrade, but about the same platform after a few software updates. I also liked that in normal use, you hardly get the chance to hear the fans. The chassis heats up very little, and this, combined with the low noise level, makes the VivoBook S15 just as useful at work as at home, for movies or listening to music. But what left me speechless is the simply sensational battery life. We're not talking about 8, not about 12, but about more than 16 hours of battery life in our tests. The manufacturer boasts more than 18, but from what we tested, we are indeed talking about battery life comparable to a smartphone, which is formidable considering the processing power this laptop has. And I haven't even mentioned the other ace up the VivoBook S15's sleeve, that NPU with 45 trillion operations per second. Together with Microsoft's Copilot, but not only, this laptop can be an excellent tool for learning and productivity, in the right fields and with users who know what they're doing. From live translation to generating images based on sketches or text, from special effects in video calls to automatic sorting of media files, from natural language assistant to noise cancelling, the features that the VivoBook S15 is capable of have enormous potential. And I believe that the current features are just the beginning, and the NPU can be used in many more ways by programmers, designers, etc. Likewise, for education, this NPU can provide a significant boost, but as I mentioned earlier, the condition is that it must be used correctly. And I say correctly because what the VivoBook S15 cannot do is perform truly heavy tasks. It doesn't have enough horsepower for that, and I don't foresee a future Qualcomm processor that will compete with the heavyweights of x86 or Apple's M Ultra. But what the VivoBook S15 is an almost perfect laptop for office and multimedia, far ahead of anything on x86. If I were to tease Asus a bit, it's a MacBook Air with Windows and a lot of AI. It has similar weight, slightly superior performance, and more importantly, similar battery life. The AI features are just beginning, and with the presence of the NPU, they have the potential to become exponentially more useful. In this context, Apple's competitive advantage maintained for 4 years has somewhat evaporated, and the purchasing decision now comes down to ecosystem and interface, where, let's be realistic, Apple still has a significant lead. The price of the VivoBook S15 is $1,300, comparable to a 15-inch MacBook Air M3, but as Windows applications receive native ARM support, the VivoBook S15 and all laptops following this recipe will increasingly represent a real alternative to the Apple platform. Did I like the laptop? Yes, I did. Sure, there are still nuts and bolts to tighten both on the software side and on the hardware side, until we have a complete, coherent, and hiccup-free experience. But the start has been made, and Apple is no longer running alone. I eagerly await the x86 camp's response and look forward to seeing how AI features will be implemented on other types of processors with NPUs. I'm also curious to see what other players are preparing. Rumors have it that Nvidia wants to re-enter this game, so the future looks bright and the sky is the limit. And now, tell me in the comments. How do you find Windows on ARM? What do you think about this infusion of artificial intelligence into everything? And lastly, will all this determine you to buy such a laptop? Do these evolutions represent a sufficient argument to make you spend $1,300 for a brand new laptop like this? Or you rather wait a little bit more? Thank you for being with us. Subscribe here on our Tiny Technology channel, and I wish you all the best.